working journey. So these are things we have like summarized and we'll be taking today in the webinar. And of course, certain, you know, once you know you have to do invoicing, what are the other things that you also have to do, how your systems have to get ready, and what are the subsequent steps, the precursors and all that you have to take care of. We'll try to touch upon as many of those as possible in our session today. And you know, IRIS, just a brief introduction of us. So IRIS is one of the global compliance solution providers. So we you know, cover the entire range of companies, you know, range of, I would say, participants. One, starting from the government, for whom we build the solution so that they can monitor the company, to the companies who have to, you know, meet the mandate which the regulators give them. So we have both ends of the spectrum to whom you know, we provide the solutions, and not only India but in, globally. And in India, we are, you know, one of the GSP selected in the first round way back in 2017. And you know, since then we have been like, you know, able to, you know, create more and more innovative, and you know, the products that we have created, which caters to not only the compliance, the GST compliance that is there, but it also, you know, stretches beyond what you would typically need in the GST. So we are one of the, you know, leading GST solution, so with GSP and a ASP as well. And with me in session today, we have Vaishali, who is you know, one of the best brains, if I can say, you know, in the industry, who knows not only the technology, but also the domain. So she's a chartered accountant. And so the subject matter, obviously an expert in subject matter, but at the same time, she's also expert now in technology, and you know, has been closely working with the government themselves, the government team who is implementing the system. So you know, it will be very enriching experience, I would say, that you know, to hear from her that how things have been shaping up, what are the new updates and all. So I let her do most of the talking when it comes to the nitty-gritties of the overall e-invoicing in India. And you know, like I said, today we'll briefly touch upon what are the various areas of the mandate, what all you need to know about the mandate, and some things before and after the mandate, what are to be taken care of. And you can keep on posting your queries or questions if you have any in the Q&A section. And as we are going ahead with the session, we can take up those questions. And any, if remain unaddressed, we will probably handle it subsequently. So if you look at the overall GST land, the compliance landscape that has happened in India, it started way back in 2017 where GST was introduced. So we all know it is a big transformational thing, and also it changed many things. You know, it was not just a law transformation, but transformation in many other areas as well. And after GST, what came was e-way bill. E-way bill again, GST was more of a reporting, the external reporting. E-way bill, you know, made it more transactional, and also a unique a centralized system where a unique number was given. And the same thing got extended now in 2020, where we are. It starts, you know, more at the beginning, where whenever you are creating a document, you have to get the document first registered with the government, and only then it gets treated as valid. So the compliance actually has trickled down. What started from an external reporting has actually gone down to the invoice level. And even from invoice level, before a document gets considered as a valid, it has to be registered with the government first. So in terms of how the teams in the company have been, you know, have been reshuffled, and then tasks have been changing. Earlier, what was only an indirect taxation team's role, you know, just to create the GST return, do the two-way reconciliation and all, it got extended to the supply chain, that is the operational team, because e-way bill was involved. So when the goods are moving out, the invoice has to be sent to the e-way bill system to get a unique number. So it all started with that. And then it further trickled down to the actual now accounts team, or in fact, every, I would say, department in the organization which deals with generating of a document for which you have to get an e-invoice generated. So from just one team, it has now, you know, spread its impact on many of the functions that are, you know, operating in an organization. So that is how the overall GST as a compliance has been evolved. So many cases that we see actually globally also, generally how it starts, there is first e-invoicing comes in and then the reporting comes in. But in India, I think we first started with the external reporting, and now it has trickled down to e-invoicing. And you know, like we say here, e-invoicing, though it is, you know, it's the last one to come in the picture, but it is, you know, at the very start of any journey. So only when you have created a document, you will be able to move your goods, and only if you have created a document, you will be actually reporting it in your return. So e-invoicing, though came in, was the last entry, but is the foundation of everything that is there. So now, when we look at, you know, implementing e-invoice internally for, as a company, as a taxpayer, when you have to evaluate also the impact of e-invoice, it is not just e-invoice in standalone. You cannot see e-invoice in isolation, but you have to see, you know, how the spread is and where all it impacts. So the very first one, you know, when you think starting about e-invoicing is, of course, the mandate itself, where you have to, you would need to see what are the data elements that are required to generate an e-invoice. Though from the list of items, I won't say that your companies are not capturing any of these items, but it could be more the other way around, where you have something specific, but the government list does not have it included in their standard list. That's when you have to start figuring out and seeing how best you can do the mapping and how you would need to address the specific cases. We will also be touching upon that in big detail in our session today. You know, like the case of TCS is there. It is something which is new but not there in the standard. So how it is to be addressed. So some of those things also we will be talking about today. Then once you know what data you need, the second is obviously to generate the IRN. So when I'm saying IRN, essentially the unique number that comes to you from the government. And along with that, if it is a transaction which involves goods, you also need an e-way bill number. And because it is a sales transaction, it also has to go into your GSTR1. So though it is e-invoice, at an invoice level, you have to see its impact in the other areas as well. And again, it is not every invoice, every transaction that you have done will require an IRN number, but an e-invoice or through an e-way bill number, because there are many now. While a lot of data is overlapping, there are some things which are not common across everything, you know, like a delivery challan for which you may need an e-way bill, but you may not need an e-invoice. Or there are cases like a B2C transaction which does not need an e-invoice, but it has to be reported in GSTR. So there are some cases like this, which again, when you are implementing a solution or thinking of upgrading your systems to handle e-invoicing, these all items or these all also are the things that you will have to take into consideration. And while you have done all these compliances, what data you need, what processes you need to have in place, the downstream analysis and reconciliation, because what I have reported in my e-invoice, has it gone in my GSTR1? What has come in my GSTR2A? Do I have an invoice supporting it? So all these kind of reconciliations and all, which are again, that could be kind of periodic activities and all, are also something to be factored in. So when we say e-invoice, it's, you know, not the last mile that we are touching upon. In fact, now we are going to the root from where the things originate. And therefore, when any solution or any implementation that is being thought for e-invoice, there are something fundamental or the basic pillars that have to be also, you know, thought about, because you cannot look at each of these compliances separately. So you need to have a one-stop solution which can probably have one universe list of data fields, one single sign-on using which you can access all your various compliances. So that is something you would need to take into account. So this is how e-invoicing as a journey starts. So I'm right now just touching upon the, I would say the key, the 30,000 feet view, if I can say, of what are the various aspects and things that you would need, particularly in e-invoicing. And details, obviously, we'll be covering it in our session today. And just a brief journey of e-invoicing in India. So how it began, it was like way back in 2019 when just a committee was set up, to now where the mandate will slowly, you know, kick in for companies above taxpayers above turnover 100 aggregate turnover over 100 crores. So in October 2020, the companies with 500 crores have already gone live. And initially some relaxation was given to them. Will same happen for companies with 100 crores? We don't know. But because now we already have a set of companies who have implemented, have their experience. So that is something, you know, all the newcomers and all the new players will need to take into account. And if you see, recently there have been many cases of fake invoices and fraud IT claims and all bit of them in the news for in the recent past. So what do you think is, you know, anyway, government also plans to have e-invoicing for all the taxpayers. So given the quantum and the number of frauds that are surfacing, this could happen in fact sooner than later. That is what we think. But obviously, we don't know what the government plans are. But eventually, someday, it will be all taxpayers in across India, perhaps. Everybody will be following one standard, that is the e-invoicing standard. And with this, I'll just ask Vaishali to take over and, you know, go into deep dive into the specifics of the mandate, what it covers and what it not covers, and then we can keep it conversational and pick up the questions as they come along. So over to you, Vaishali.
Yeah.
Let's stop sharing my screen and I'll let Vaishali take over the presentation.
Hello everyone. I'll just start sharing my screen. So, you know, e-invoicing mandate has, you know, has been spoken about in last few months a lot. And though, you know, every one of you might be aware by now that what is it and, you know, how this has been introduced. I'll just take a few minutes on some you know, summarized form of the mandate. So as you all know, 500 crore above, it has already started from 1st October itself, and for 100 crore, it will start from 1st January. So today it's 1st December. So you have only 1 month if you fall within 100 to 500 crore category to, you know, ensure that you are ready by 1st Jan. So what are the type of transactions that are covered for reporting? It is B2B export, SEZ supplies deemed export, and B2B reverse charge invoices are covered. So, you know, all the outward supply invoices which fall under these categories will have to be reported to NIC for getting an IRN. So, you know, it is not raising or rather creating an invoice on the government portal. It is registering an invoice on the government portal. So, you know, all the data points that, you know, typically an invoice has, you need to send those data points in a prescribed format to the government and get back the IRN and some other details in response. So if you see, there are only three document types allowed. It is, you know, a tax invoice or debit notes and credit notes. So only these transactions will be allowed for IRN generation. So essentially, bill of supply is not covered for IRN generation. Also, B2C is not covered for, you know, IRN generation. Apart from this, if you see, the responsibility of IRN generation is of the supplier. So when we talk about B2B reverse charge invoices, these are those invoices where, you know, as a registered supplier, if you have certain services which come under RCM, then in such cases, you as a supplier are supposed to generate the IRN and not the recipient. And, you know, only suppliers are allowed to generate IRN or e-commerce operator on behalf of suppliers. So you may have some transactions through e-commerce portal, then you can, then the e-commerce operator can also, you know, register himself as an e-invoice, you know, enable himself for e-invoice generation using his, you know, e-com registration. And he can also generate on your behalf. B2C is excluded. There are certain other specified sectors that are also excluded, like banking, insurance, etc. Also, there are the SEZ units are exempted. So if you are SEZ unit, then IRN is not applicable. If it is an SEZ developer, it is still applicable. Apart from, you know, e-invoicing mandate, actually, there is something called as B2C self-generated QR code. So though this B2C QR code is not actually e-invoice mandate, it is a separate notification that GST Council had, you know, released saying that when, you know, for all the companies having 500 crore about turnover, they are also required to compulsorily generate a QR code, which is a dynamic QR code. And it should be in such a way that, you know, scan and pay should be available to the customers. So now what essentially this means is, you know, usually when you go to any shops, they have a kind of Paytm QR codes, etc., where you scan and, you know, automatically the recipient's bank details, etc., are, you know, based on UPI, automatically these things are available and, you know, automatically the amount gets deducted. So those are all static QR codes. So you have to enter the amount. Here they are expecting that you are you generate a dynamic QR code, which will include the amount. So this is a separate, you know, separate kind of mandate that has come. It is not, you know, you need not send B2C invoice to government portal for generating QR. Government NIC or GSTN has nothing to do with this mandate. This is internally the companies have to generate. This is this B2C QR is also applicable from 1st December. So from today onwards, ideally, you know, all your B2C invoices should have QR only for above 500 crore companies. However, you know, yesterday itself, there was a notification released, which has, you know, kind of relaxed this provision that, you know, if you are not following QR from 1st December till 31st March, that will also be okay, provided that you follow it from 1st April. So if you do not follow from 1st April also, then penalty provisions will be applicable with effect from 1st December. So that is how they have, you know, given a new notification regarding the same. Now, you know, who are the actual parties to this transaction? So there is a taxpayer who will send invoice details to IRP. IRP is the invoice registration portal from where you will get IRN, which is invoice reference number. You'll get an acknowledgement number, date, status, and signed QR code and signed invoice data. Now, these fields are received as a JSON text. So it is a, you know, it is a language in which it is received back. And this content is to be stored in by the taxpayer into his systems, because only then you will be able to print the signed QR code on your invoice. Now, when you send that invoice to your registered customer here, you have to send invoice with the signed QR code. So you can use the same invoice print that you are using, but additionally add a QR code on that invoice, which is this signed QR code. Now, you know, if you do not generate an IRN and, you know, without IRN, you send it to registered customer, then there are applicable penal provisions for that also. Second step here is from the IRP, there are existing two systems already of the government where you are currently doing your, you know, compliances. One is e-label system, which is for movement of your goods, and one is GSTN, which is your return filing, or rather paying your liability. Now here from, you know, when you generate an IRN through IRP, what they are additionally also doing is, along with IRN, you can also generate the e-way bill directly. So now once you generate an IRN plus e-way bill, your e-way bill will go to the e-way bill system. And from there, the other actions of your movement, like, you know, if you want to update your vehicle details, so in case of breakdown, etc., or you want to extend the validity or any other actions that you want to take, you can take it from the e-way bill system. So e-way bill system will not go away. It is going to stay. However, now, you know, while you generate IRN, you need to also generate e-way bill, you know, from the IRP portal itself. So you will not be allowed to generate e-way bill from the e-way bill system for all the IRN generated transactions. Now here, you know, so from IRP, the next step is GSTR1 auto-population. So the IRP portal will also auto-populate GSTR1 of your month for which you have generated IRNs. And from there, 2A will be the regular flow that goes to the registered customer. So this is the entire flow that is planned. So as, you know, Shirvam said that here, when, you know, though e-invoicing is, as it has been introduced at the end, but now it will be the beginning point of all the transactions. Now, let us understand what are the invoice API details. So if you see, there are in all there are 11 APIs that have been released. There are 5 APIs which relate directly to the actions regarding the IRN, and there are 6 other APIs which are like miscellaneous APIs which you may or may not use. So first is authentication. Of course, when you connect to the NIC system, you need to authenticate yourself that the data is coming from a correct source. So whether it is through it is directly via API or through a GSP, authentication is to be used. Generation of IRN is your regular all the data points in the invoice. You are supposed to send that in this API and get back the IRN details. Canceling an IRN, so you can cancel your IRN within 24 hours. It can happen that you may have generated IRN, but later on within 24 hours, if you find that the invoice is canceled, then you can cancel the IRN. Then there is generate evable by IRN, which is if in case while generating IRN you are not able to give transport details for movement of goods, then you can give that details via a separate API, which is generate evable by IRN. Now, what is the difference between this generate evable by IRN and existing generate evable that is there on the evable system? The basic difference is when you generate an IRN, you are already sending your invoice details. Now, and also while generating evable through evable system, you are sending again the same invoice detail. Now with this API, that is generate evable by IRN, you need not send all the invoice details. You just send the IRN number and the transport details, and your invoice will evable will be generated. So this is essentially to avoid the duplication of data that is present on both the systems. So this will that is why they are planning to block evable from the evable system for all the invoices where IRN is required. So that will be blocked sooner. And then there is cancel evable. Again, cancel evable may be due to various cases while, generally evable if you have provided wrong transport details or wrong vehicle number, etc. Then you can cancel evable and regenerate your evable. Now here one more point is if your evable is already generated, then you cannot even cancel IRN. So you have to cancel evable first and then cancel your IRN. Now, list of next APIs, fetching the data, fetching the entire IRN data, that is whatever data you had sent to IRP for IRN generation, you can fetch back that data using get invoice by IRN. So you need to send IRN number and get back the data, or you can send by document details, that is you can send document type, number and date, and you can retrieve your invoice data. So again, note that these APIs are for the suppliers. So it is not that if a supplier has generated an IRN for an invoice which is raised against you, you cannot fetch that detail using these APIs as of now. So as of now, these are only supplier centric, not recipient, not allowed for the recipients. Get evable by IRN, again this is give the IRN number and get the evable details like evable number, validity date, etc. Get GSTN, this is like similar to what is there on eWayBill portal, which will give you GSTN name, its location, then the block status, it is cancelled or active. So this is this API will give you that details. Sync GSTN details from CP. CP is the common portal, that is GSTN common portal. So if at all at NIC system, the data is not updated, you can use this API to update the NIC taxpayer database. Sometimes what happens is, on the NIC system, the GSTN is mentioned as cancelled. However, on the GSTN system, it is active. Many a times there is an auto cancellation that is done by GSTN, which may have been updated on the NIC. But later on when, it got from cancelled to active, then it was not updated on the NIC portal. So this API will help you update that. So if you get an error for GSTN, you can use this API and update the data. Let's check API. This is like checking the working condition of NIC, whether it is, working correctly or not. Now, quickly I'll go through how.
Shani,
yeah.
Yeah, just to add here, because we already have many questions, so maybe we'll just, and those are related to mandate. So maybe we can also take up those questions. So you can stop presenting, we'll take up questions, answer that, and stop presenting your screen.
Yeah.
And maybe one by one we can. So you can stop sharing your screen. That should be, yeah, okay, great. So I'll pick up from where we had left last. There is one question where can we offer e-invoicing voluntarily, or only those who have the turnover limits can go for it? So there's no, I think, voluntary option. Only if your turnover, earlier it was 500, now it is 100. So only if your turnover is above 100, only then the sandbox or the trial portal access will be enabled for you. Next, maybe Vaishali, if you can say, which are the types of businesses exempted from this mandate?
Yes, so the notifications, etc., if you see, it is banks, financial institutions, certain GTAs, etc., are there. But they have been notified actually in the normal notification. They have exempted these businesses, and SEZ units also are exempted.
Okay, and apart from this API access, which is there for GSPs, is there any offline utility of the government through which e-invoice can be generated?
Yes, so there is an offline utility that government has released, so you can use that. So it is similar to for e-way bill or even for GST filings. So you Excel utility through which you can put the data, convert it into a JSON format, and then upload the JSON on the government portal. So that is
okay. Another one is, I think, for backdated invoices. So what if invoices dated 30th November is generated on 1st of December?
Mm-hmm.
What if invoice is dated? So then can IRN be generated for such invoice?
Yes, so IRN generation, currently there are no validations on the document date that you cannot generate on backdated invoice. Only additional validation they have just recently added is it should not be before 1st October, because e-invoice is applicable from 1st October. So all invoices dated before 1st October, no IRN can be generated for those invoices.
Okay, and is there any maximum time limit for dispatching the consignment after IRN is generated?
No, not technically, nor even law has not prescribed any time limit. So on the portal, they have not introduced any kind of validation for this.
Okay, and the new notification, which was for B2C, the exemption got shifted to 1st of March. So can you just repeat that again?
So what they have said is actually as per the old notification, B2C QR was supposed to go live from 1st October. It was again deferred to 1st December. And now the new notification says that if you have not you can avoid generating QR from December to March 2021, provided from 1st April you are following the of QR code. So the penalty provisions regarding if you have not generated for December invoices a QR, then the penalty will not be applicable.
Okay. I hope that clarifies what is the new notification about. And as we are answering questions, I can see more and more questions only are popping up, but maybe I'll pick up a few ones. Another one is, would IRP generate QR code also? So answer is yes. When you send, register an invoice with the government, what government will give you in return? When I'm saying government, this is the invoice registration portal IRP. They will give back to you one IRN number, which is a unique number, a digitally signed QR code, and your own invoice data also in a digital format. So this is the information that you will get back when you register an invoice with the government system. And I think what somebody is also asking is, can we just show the portal so that we see what are the different and the process that is there. So maybe after this, we can directly jump to the portal, and then whatever data or whatever slide we had to show, we can then see which we want to show. So we can, after this, we can go to the portal directly. And another one is Section 8 company exempted from e-invoicing? Section 8 company. Or even maybe we'll have to check that. We'll have to check that. So maybe while I go through this question, maybe you can start you can show our solution, the e-invoicing solution. So meanwhile, I'll pull out answers for some of you.
Sure. I'll just share my screen again. Yeah, so, typically, if you see, we'll be taking you through the slides before I jump on to the integration option. I'll just, go through this slide first. So, the main purpose of having an integrated solution is to ensure that you, have all the three compliances under one roof. Also, all your other data analytics, etc., can be done through the same roof. Now, when we talk about Iris Onyx, when I'll be showing you our platform, it will be a web interface which I'm showing, which is if you do everything from our portal, then how it will work. So that will be my presentation. However, before moving to the actual iron generation, you need to understand what are the ways in which you can push data to our system. So there are four ways in which you can send data. So it is one is data API. So it is like a direct system to system integration where you integrate our APIs with into your system so that the data can be extracted and pushed to our systems. And this will be one invoice at a time you can send and get back the response for that invoice and immediately store it into your systems also. Second is upload file API. So another option is where you do not want to have single invoice approach. You want to have a bulk approach. So maybe you have multiple invoices during the day, and at the end of the day you want to kind of extract entire data set into a CSV file and push into our system for IRN and then get back the response. So that is a second option. So it is upload file API. So you can extract data in a CSV and use this API to push the CSV to our system. Then the same CSV format you can also push via SFTP. So in SFTP, SFTP is a secured FTP location where you can place your files. From there, Iris will pick up the invoices and generate IRN, send back the response, store back into your into the SFTP location, and from there you can pick up the responses. And a manual upload, that is same extraction of CSV, you can come to our login to our web portal and upload it manually instead of using any direct integration approach. So these are the four major approaches through which you can push data to our systems. So I'll now show you once you push data to our system, how IRN is going to be generated. So once I log into the system, I'll show you manual upload approach today. So we call our solution as an integrated solution because we have all the three compliances under one roof. So with a single sign-on, you can do your e-invoicing, manage your e-invoicing operations. So we call our invoicing solution as Onyx. Our e-way bill is called as Topaz, and return filing and other reconciliation reporting module is called as Sapphire. So once you log in, you can go to e-invoicing module. From here, basically, you will be able to upload data for your invoice. Before uploading, there is a one-time onboarding process that our support team will kind of onboard you onto our platform. So this is essentially adding your business hierarchy into our systems. So there is an option in settings whereby you can add your GSTNs into our systems, or our support team will add the GSTNs and give you access accordingly. Once you add the GSTNs, we give one access to a person from your company, you can then invite multiple users to whom you want to give access. This you can do at PAN level or at GSTN level. So if you see, we have added so many GSTNs under one legal PAN. So you can have multiple GSTINs, and at the GSTN level itself also you can give access to users. So you can go to GSTN level and then give access. So those who have access to only one GSTN, they will be able to see only this GSTN in their view. They'll not be able to see the entire hierarchy. Similarly, we have POB level also. So we have gone one step below GSTN. So POB, why we have introduced, because in eWay Bill also there were various locations through which you generate your invoices or move your goods. So this place of business concept has been added by us. So you can add your place of businesses, and each user at that particular place of business can be given access to this this level, so that he'll be able to see data only for his place of business. I'll just show you how exactly the data will IRN will be generated. So I'll go to again 29. So post generation of IRN, you'll be able to see data here. Now I'll upload one data. So I'll show you a CSV file. So this is some dummy data that I have already created. There are three invoices for which I am going to generate IRN as of now. So this is our input format in which we have all the e-invoicing fields plus certain extra fields for maybe if you want to use our custom printing module, then you can add it, or for other reporting purposes, if you want that data to be stored into our systems, then you can add those fields. So though e-invoicing mandate has only 138 fields, our input format may have 200 plus odd fields, because we cover all the compliances at one stage. So all the fields that are required for other compliances also we have added in this format itself. Now I'll just upload this invoice. So what we usually do is when we generate an invoice, in the history we give you the response also from here. So if you have done a manual approach, you have followed a manual approach, we give you the IRN response from here itself, so that you can take back these files. So this is a standard response that we give, where we give the signed QR, we give the IRN number, we give the acknowledgement number, acknowledgement date, status, etc., so that you can take back these files into your systems and integrate all your data. Also, we show it on the portal. So if you see, we have generated three invoices. We have generated IRN plus eWay Bill. So if you see, this is the IRN, this is the QR code, how it looks like from the acknowledgement number, status, etc. Then there is eWay Bill. So eWay Bill details also are present over here. So once the invoice comes here, after this, if you want to download the data into Excel or email, email or print or cancel, then all these actions are available from our portal. Essentially, one more thing, as I said, it is an integrated solution. That means even for other documents, like whether it is a bill of supply or whether it is a delivery challan or whether it is a B2C invoice, we also allow you to upload that data here, so that your GSTR1 compliance as well as your eWay Bill compliance can be taken care of. So you can upload your delivery challans, etc. also from here, and e-way bill can be generated, provided you have taken access opted for an integrated solution. If you have opted only for e-invoicing solution, then these two things are will not be done. So this is how our module looks like. And as I said, custom template. So suppose now if you want to print this into a custom template, so we have a separate custom template module where our team defines kind of all the custom templates. So if you want a specific template for your domestic, or if you want a specific for your export, then you can accordingly draft a custom template. So that our team does, and you will be able to a PDF that you usually do, including your logo, including the QR and other details. So you can also add your terms and conditions, etc. Even if while you are sending the data, you have not added, you can add this. So we have, this is one of our modules that is widely being used by a lot of companies. So this is how you can also print using custom template. And also email is there, so you can email invoices from here. So you can put email ID of the customer or whoever you want to email. So you can send, this is a standard text that we provide, and that can be mailed. Also, additionally, for SFTP, etc., we also have custom PDF templates going back to the SFTP location, because many clients have complete automation. So once IRN is generated, not just the response files, but PDF of the templates also get sent to the SFTP location. So that is also available. Apart from that, we also have download in GSTR1 format. So if you want to upload from our Sapphire module, if you want to file return, then you can download your GSTR1 from here and upload it in Sapphire, and then go ahead for your GSTR1 return filing. So an update that also I would like to share is earlier November month, GSTR1 was going to be auto-populated by GSTN, but they have just released a note saying that they will not be auto-populating November month's data. They will be populating December month's data. So for November month, you are supposed to still save as you do regularly. So that is how currently it is there. So this is our overall module. So we are adding more things to this. Currently, this is just the basic mandate and basic requirements that we have added. We'll be adding dashboards. We'll be adding archive data from archived downloads, etc. So that will also be added sooner. So this is how our actual thing looks like. So if you push data through API, whether you push data through SFTP. Once data is pushed to our system, you will be able to see the data from here. So irrespective of whatever option you choose, you will be able, every time you will be able to view the data from here. So this is our integrated solution. So so from when once the e-bill is generated also, it will move to the e-bill portal. So from here you can take the other actions on e-bill. So once it is moved to e-bill portal, we have different options on the e-bill system. Like I said, e-bill update part B, update transporter, extend validity, etc. will always be as is. The way NIC has done it, similarly here also, it's not, all these actions are not available through IRP portal, but they are available through e-bill portal. So that will continue.
Yeah, so that was in a brief what our solution is and what are the various stages through which a typical invoice will go through. First generation of IRN, then going to e-way bill, and then what are the subsequent things that are involved. So I can see that there are many questions, but then we'll take up now a bit of things, maybe what we had intended to cover in the session today, some high level points also we'll touch upon, and then we can again pick up the questions, which I see many are still related to a bit of mandate also. And some things are more of related to e-way bill, like how closely these are related, when I can generate e-way bill, what are the other things that I can do in e-way bill. So those all we will also take up. So just before that, I will finish some of the other key pointers which we wanted to highlight today before we again go back to questions. So I'm sharing my screen. So the application that we just showed right now was way through which you can generate IRN that is, you send your invoice and we send it to the IRP portal and get back the IRN and the QR code for you. But even now, when you start receiving a QR code, the next task also would be to just check whether that QR code is valid, what is the content of QR code. And this feature is what we are providing in our another app, which is quite popular when it comes to GST IN searching. So here again, so till now our app Peridot, if you had a GST and you could just scan and get the entire history of the filing and also the addresses. Now in this, the new version, which is which would be so right now released as a beta version, and the full release is expected in a week. So in that, you will find an option of scanning a QR code. So once you scan a QR code, whether it is actually digitally signed by NIC, you would come to know, and the other details that are there in the e-invoice. So these are the standard information items that is there in any particular QR code. And if it is created by NIC, only then you can see that it is a digitally, it is a valid IRN that is created. So this is another thing that once you start your e-invoicing, and another piece of solution is something you may need, because once you start getting also IRN, once you start getting QR code, you'll have to verify whether whatever is there on the QR code is it okay or not okay. So that is another piece that you may another utility thing that also could be required. So now when we saw actually how the whole flow is for a for e-invoice, that is, it starts from getting the data out of your system, sending it to another system, and from there it goes to government and gets the data back. So then there's a lot of the initial or the main critical activity. It actually starts with identifying what are the various data points that are there in your system and how do I extract the information. And also Vaishali mentioned that while government systems enlists only about 138 fields, and in our list of data fields we have many more, because we are meeting many other use cases as well. So it is not limited to e-invoicing alone, but in the same we have e-way bill, and then additionally if anything is required for GST compliance, and plus we also have something for internal purposes, because as we are seeing, many of the companies, they always have any invoice or something which is associated, say, with their internal department or with some of their users or something or the other. So there are a lot many extra information which is often associated with an invoice, and which they later on would like to filter an invoice based on their own conditions. So just have a look at how many invoices, what all data pertains to their own department, their own region. So these all additional information which is often linked to an invoice. So we also have catered to those level of details in our list of data items. Of course, all these are options. So if you want to go for further downstream analysis and help and want to do all this level of tracking, you can always use those set of fields. Otherwise, whatever is then minimum mandatory for an e-invoice, if you just want to get started with that, that also is an option. Hence, the decision or the very first thing that as a company, when you're starting your e-invoicing, you have to figure out, okay, what is it that I want to start? Is it I want to start only mandatory and then eventually go to all, or I want to do a big bang approach, once and all I extract everything and all my compliances are met? So this is one key decision that happens when you are starting your e-invoicing. And also along with it, then the next step comes is when you want to generate an IRN, because and document will become valid only when it has an IRN number on it. So is it that you want in my ERP system, when I'm saying generate invoice, at that stage itself the IRN should get generated, which is a real-time basis, or you want to have a batch process where at the end of the day all the documents that were generated in my system, those will go to the government system and get generated? So what is your currently invoicing process that you follow, and how you want to align it to the invoicing process? This is the another thing that is important, because again, based on it, how you want to integrate will be defined. Like you know, we just briefly mentioned here, we have different integration options. Do you want to go for a direct integration, that is an API data integration, where in real time you send me one invoice data, immediately we send back to you IRN, of course, depending on how much time the government system takes to generate the IRN. But if there are other cases where, you know, the internal system may not have all the data on the real time, you have to get data extracted from different systems and then collate and then send, or there are any restrictions in connecting the systems to any external system, and so you want just a data dump out from your system and then from there on the processing takes place, then all those various options depending and the flexibility is depending on what you need. It's something you'll have to explore and see that your solution is able to also take care of that. But this is a decision when you're implementing your e-invoice, when you want e-invoice to be generated, real-time, batch, and how the thing will be. And also right now, there is no restriction on how much backdated and IRN, how much for a backdated invoice and IRN can be generated. But suppose if it comes in future, then is it that something you have done now will have to, be drastically changed or something? Also should be, one of the perspectives that can be again thought of. So one is how much data you want to extract, then at what stage you want the IRN to be generated, because solutions can have any flexibility that you want to have. And once you are a bit of clear on what are these things, then the next thing is determine that which set of teams and what all processes, changes have to be done internally versus what your partners and what the solutions provider will do. Because as always, there is a time limit by when these things have to be done. And there are some things which do take a long, there's a long lead time in getting maybe even one small change run in ERP system or something. Taking that into account also, determines at times what could be your short-term strategy versus what could be your long-term strategy. So these are some of the things, when you start your e-invoice implementation, to be kept in view that, okay, how you want your e-invoicing to be, how closely it has to be aligned to your processes, so that accordingly your next steps and your solutions can be customized accordingly. Other things that will come in here is if your invoice printing is there. So now the government, now with e-invoicing, what has happened is the QR code has to be necessarily printed on the invoice. So if it has to be printed on invoice, your current template has to be changed. So do you want to change it internally or you want it to be done outside your system? If to be done internally, what are the changes required? And also there are many these, many things which actually go into making your e-invoicing implementation happen. Of course, these all are one-time or kind of less frequent activities, because once this is done, then subsequently it is just a transactional thing that, generating of invoice that keeps on happening. And from our product perspective, if I actually have to say in Onyx, because we provide multiple options for integration, one is do you want to do direct data or, instead of one by one at a time, if you want to go for bulk or batch mode, that also you can do via API. So when we say API, APIs are essentially system-to-system connection where no human intervention ideally is needed. Your system will generate something. It gets pushed to our system. Our system will push to government system. Government will return back something. We will return back to you. So that is how the journey is. API is completely for system-to-system transfer. But if there are any restrictions, like I said, due to which the systems cannot directly talk to external systems, then the option to extract data and keep it at a place and do the things can always be looked at. And the manual upload. So manual upload is what we just demonstrated today. So whatever you can do, whatever we showed you as part of manual process, where you can upload, you can view, you can download, this portal, this web portal will be available irrespective of whichever option you choose. But manual, because it helps to visualize how the steps are, that is what we showcase today. So depending on at what stage you are, hence that poll when I was saying that we need to know at what stage you are, this is where it matters, because depending on which stage you are and what type of things you are deciding how much to extract, how much not to extract, your subsequent activities will get determined. And before I move to the purchase cycle, maybe let me take a pause and Vaishali, we go back to the Q&A questions again. Where we had left last time was section 8. So section 8 is a not-for-profit entity. And I don't think explicitly not-for-profit entity is exempted, but the exemption is only given for heavily consumer, B2C type of companies like banking, insurance, and telecom. So not-for-profit is not explicitly exempted is what I understand. Right, Vishali? Okay. Where will be exempted? Okay. So if goods are to be transported in two vehicles against single involved, how can that be done?
Yeah, so essentially when you see currently also when when you generate an invoice, it is a single invoice, but while the goods, sometimes because in case when it is a, knockdown, you have to transport via knockdown conditions, etc. So there is an option available to transport goods via delivery challan. So the way they have mentioned in the FAQs, etc., that whenever there is a semi-knockdown or complete knockdown transaction, then in that case, while generating e-way bills, it will be via delivery challan. IRN will be generated for an invoice, and the invoice copy will be attached with all the trucks, all the e-way bills, and the final invoice, the actual original invoice will be with the last truck. This is how it will go ahead. So there cannot be, multiple e-way bills for one invoice. One invoice will always have one e-way bill. Multiple e-way bills can be handled only via delivery challan. So that is how it will be.
Okay. And I think that is how it is also happening right now, where of course IRN is just a new thing that has come in, but even now, when you had one invoice, you had to go via delivery challan mode only. Then next, for e-way bill, transporter ID is compulsory and transporter will have a GSTN number.
For e-way bill, transporter ID is not compulsory. So it depends upon how you want to generate an e-way bill. Is it only part you want to generate, that is your transporter, will generate the, will update the vehicle details, etc. Usually what happens is, when you start your movement of goods, that you don't know how, things are going to move, which truck it will go, or, whether it will go by rail or road. So many companies have this practice of generating e-way bill. They just put transporter and they don't put any vehicle details. Then it is a party slip that is called, and it doesn't have a validity. So transporter will update the vehicle details and generate an actual movement slip. So that is how the flow is. So transporter ID is compulsory if part A is to be generated, otherwise it is not compulsory. And yes, transporter will have a GSTN number, so it is a registration number that is to be put.
Okay, and this turnover limit of 100 crores, so which financial year is to be seen for this?
So any financial year from 2017 onwards, so since the time of introduction, so whether it is 17, 18, 18, 19 or 19, 20, in any of the three financial year, if your turnover exceeds 100, then it will, your IRN will be applicable, not the current financial year.
Okay. And can we generate after cancelling an IRN using the same invoice number? Can a new IRN be generated?
No, so they have not allowed that because IRN will, once you cancel an IRN, same document number cannot be used. You will have to issue a fresh invoice with a new invoice number.
Okay, so if there are any clerical errors in the e-invoice, how can those be corrected?
Correct. So, we had asked the same kind of questions to NIT, and, they always had this point that when you, if clerical errors are happening, now this data is also coming from your systems. So, mostly, their viewpoint was when you are generating an invoice, okay, So in that, so clerical errors can happen even in your accounting systems. So do your accounting systems allow, you know, editing that invoice? So that is a typical answer that they give. So you know, currently, you know, they are expecting that this e-invoice will, you know, mostly be automated. So even though currently if you're planning to do it manually, you know, they are expecting that this will come through your, it has to come through your system. So even if you use government offline utility, it is very important that you automate that data into the offline utility, because then only your clerical error will go away, though this may take time. So even for above 500 crores, anyways, you know, majority go for automation. 100 to 500 will also go for automation. I don't think many may go for, obviously, even if they are going at the starting stage, then, you know, it is possible that initially they may go manually. But currently, if there are any errors in e-invoice, the only way is if you, you can cancel and generate a fresh invoice. Again, having said that, if goods have already moved against that, you know, IRN, then again, you cannot do anything but, you know, make changes in your GSTR1, etc. So this is the way they have, you know, mentioned.
Okay. And so then what about amendment? Can that invoice be amended?
So same. Similar to, you know, any edits that you do in GSTR1, amendment section will also be open in GSTR1. But there is no, you know, there is no added for IRN on amended invoices. So, you know, if you want to amend, so amendment essentially is a return filing term, if you ask me. So once you file an invoice in a particular month, and if you then realize that you have done some mistake, then you amend that invoice. So in that case also, you know, if there are major differences in the tax amounts, etc., then they are going to generate MIS reports, etc., and send it to the tax officers. So whether you edit the data in the same month or amend the data in next month, these will be made available to the tax officer. So you have to ensure that, because everything will now, you know, they are expecting that on in all the three places has to be same. That is why e-way bill they are going to block. Similarly, GSTR1 also they are auto-populating. So majority chances of amendment will reduce.
Okay. And anyways, I think, you know, like Vaishali also rightly pointed out, when the scope of amendments and these things eventually is expected to come down, because things should be automated. So what you're generating an invoice in your ERP system, you know, straight away via API or something, it should go to government systems, and one government system is sending to another government system. So that is what I think the ideal world or the ideal scenario everybody is thinking. And so we also hope that things would come down for amendment stroke cancellation.
Yeah, and also you think from ITC point of view, if you amend also, then how it will work on the recipient side will again be a question, because you know, currently though amended invoices are preferred over original, but IRN generation for amended invoices, there is nothing on that. So you know, clearly when we you know, tell clients, it is always you know, you cancel or you adjust via credit debit note. However, what happens is practically, if you see the movement has already started, so you cannot really cancel the invoice also if there are clerical errors. So it becomes very difficult. It will be difficult in the initial stages. So in any case, you will have to you know, answer government officials whether you cancel or whether you you know, edit it on the GSTR1. Anything you do, any kind of mistakes, you will have to you know, you will be answerable to the government officials if they come across all such cases.
Correct. So I think more than then, hence amendment, the other better route could be, you know, through issuing credit and debit notes, if that is, you know, one true good way of doing is what we feel. Though of course, these are not like solicited opinions, if I can say, but you know, a way through which you can also address any changes is via debit and credit note. The next question here is, I think NIC portal is not on, somebody is not able to register on NIC portal for 100 crore. So I think they will have to write it to NIC only that they are not able to register themselves. So for, I mean,
yes,
not allowing.
So, So it is, so it is like, if it is 100 to 500 crores, then first of all, I think enablement, invoice enablement will have to be done. So definitely, if it is more than 500, they should be able to register on the trial portal also. But for 100 to 500, they'll have to write it to the NIC portal. So maybe I think they will have to enable themselves first and then they'll be able to register.
Okay. So if anyone is not able to log in to the NIC portal, first write to them that they have to be enabled. Only then I think the subsequent things will be opened up for them. Another next one is e-invoice for IRP is to be issued to buyer. So I'm not sure whether e-invoice from IRP to be issued to buyer.
It's not exactly e-invoice from IRP that is issued to the buyer. It is essentially the same invoice that's to be issued to the buyer. Only you have to print the QR on that invoice, which is received from IRP. So that QR will have the IRN number, like we showed in the earlier slide, that it will have a QR code, it will have recipient GSTN, it will have main HSN, invoice value, etc. So that needs to be printed on the, so it is not necessary that the same format is printed. You can add extra fields, you can add your terms and conditions, your logo, DSC, everything you can add, and then.
Next question. Couple of one on B2C, QR code on B2C. So maybe I'll just take these. So is it required to receive payments against QR code only in case of B2C sales? So if we look at the notification, notification says that you have to have a QR code on your document, but whether now as a customer, because if you're issuing that invoice to me, whether I necessarily pay via the QR code or if I'm using any other way, that is completely at my discretion, me as a customer. So having the QR code is what mandate says, but whether the customer has to necessarily pay via QR code, the mandate and notifications are silent on those. So from a supplier perspective, you have to have a QR code. And this QR code also, the way they are saying is this QR code is should be there so that the scan and pay option is enabled. So scan and pay means any of in your mobile nowadays, all of us have our banking applications. So any of your banking applications or payment gateways, you just scan the QR code and the payment should happen. And for that to happen, the QR code also has to follow certain standards, because if say I create my own way of QR code and somebody else creates their own way of QR code, a bank application, say an SBI application, cannot read these particular QR codes. A normal banking application can read only those QR codes which are based on specific standard, and hence UPI-based QR code or Bharat QR code is what is, ways to go forward. That if you are creating a B2C invoice with a QR code, then you should be having the QR code which is in line with the UPI and Bharat code. And also there is a separate notification which RBI has issued, nothing related to GST, but RBI has said that all the companies who have their QR code, they should align themselves to either of these standards, UPI or Bharat, by March 2022. So even if for now you have any proprietary QR code, you may eventually have to move to a standard and interoperable QR code. So that is what is required. So B2C sales, so just to summarize, as a supplier, and that is also applicable to only suppliers above 500 crores. So for on an invoice, if we further drill down into invoice, it also necessarily doesn't say that you have to print it on an invoice, as long as a customer is able to see that particular QR code, be it in a digital display format or on a hard format, that also is kept and open-ended. So then finally boils down to the interpretation, how you take it. The end purpose is it should enable digital payment. So whether it is done anyhow, and it has to be any mobile application has to read it, hence it has to be standard. That is what the crux of all the notifications and the purpose of this B2C QR code is. So next is Rule 46(3) applicable even after implementing e-invoice? Sorry, I don't remember in fact what is Rule 46(3). Okay, we'll take that up later. So, or do you want to
No, even I don't remember the exact section. If someone, yeah, if this can be put it into what section is this, yeah, we'll be able to answer.
So maybe we'll take that towards the end. Then we have, so again, there is one, I think, which is more product related. So this we will answer maybe privately, that I won't pick it up here. Next, I think a section which actually we completely did not touch upon in our session, is TCS amount to be shown on face of invoice?
Yeah, so again, which TCS this is. So if you see currently also there are TCS is already, since GST. So TCS on scrap sale is there, then TCS on certain amount car sale is also. So all these are already reported in the invoice. Now this new provision that has come, TCS, where you know above a certain the supplier has to charge a percentage of TCS on his on the concerned buyer, so that is based on payment. So you know, still there is no confusions whether that should be included in the invoice itself. So you know, many because this is related to payments, so it is this needs to be checked every because it is also applicable based on the amount. So if your payments cross 50 lakhs, then only you are supposed to collect. So if you include it into an invoice, then it will become then the buyer may also ask questions on that. So it really depends upon, suppose if you are reporting an a TCS in the invoice, then yes, you need to report the TCS on in the invoice also. So you will have to add that into other charges. Currently in e-invoicing, there is no field available for TCS. So you can report it under other charges because you want to include it under invoice value. So if you include it under invoice value, then you will have to report it as other charges and include it. Whether it is to be included on invoice or not, there is still a confusion on that. There is no standard answer to that. See, apart from TCS, yes, these are certain scenarios, as it has presented. So these are some more scenarios that we have been, we have come across during our 500 crore, experience. So like reverse charge and export with payment. So here also what usually happens is, a reverse charge when you supply a service or, there are certain goods where a recipient is supposed to pay that, but IRN is supposed to be generated by the supplier. So what happens is when you, when you give an invoice to the buyer, though you do not charge the tax to the customer, you report it as a separate item. So essentially, when you, for example, say taxable amount is 100 and there is 18% tax under reverse charge, which is which comes to 18. However, your invoice value will still remain 100. Now, in this case, what happens is, if you see there are validations in e-invoicing which will not allow you this transaction in this manner. So you will have to report invoice value as 118. However, now, recently on 21st of November, they have relaxed this provision. And what they say is when you report invoice value, because some businesses have this practice of reporting, inclusive of tax and exclusive of tax. So you can report it accordingly. So they will not have any errors. So whether you report 100 or 118 as invoice value in this case, it will not give you any error. Okay, so earlier there was an error if you report 100 instead of 118. Same case happens with export with payment. Then, there is a scenario of real estate where again, 2/3 of the value is taxable. So there is 1/3 is not taxable. So again, if I continue same example, so if you have 100, as your chargeable, then from that only 66 rupees is, for example, taxable. So tax percentage will apply only on 66 and it will not apply on 33. So again, your invoice value when you calculate, it will be 100 plus tax on 26. So again, here also, because of validations, there are a lot of issues. So here what happens is this 33 value you have to report under other charges. Then only your validations will work. So it's also, they have, GST and NIC had themselves, given temporary workarounds that you can include this under other charges, and also mention it in remarks that you have included abatement charges under other charges. Also here, you have to report a pre-tax value, because in this case, essentially you have a pre-tax value, which is 100, and taxable value, which is 66. So that is how you will report. And same scenario in case of amortization, a little different in this case, because here it is the reverse scenario. That is, you do not include the taxable amount, but you include the tax amount in the invoice value. That is, there is certain, certain spare parts which are, sold back to the customer. So in that case, what happens is amortization cost is put in the invoice on which tax is applicable. However, while collecting the amount from the customer, that is while deriving your invoice value, the amortization cost is reduced. So again, here, because there is no other field for reducing any value, you can report it as a discount. And again, here also, you can put pre-tax value and mention it in remarks. And similar case for unloading this in mining industry. Here also, these unloading charges are not discount given to the customers. However, these are like, borne by the suppliers. So so in this case also what happens is collecting from the consumer, you are just collecting the main charge and not unloading charges. But still while reporting in invoice, you are printing the unloading charges also. So here, you'll reduce the amount from the invoice value and report it as a discount. So these are like, certain specific industry scenarios, which, we thought it would be important to cover.
Yeah. So going back to question. So whether e-way bill can be generated manually after providing IRN in payload from 7th December.
Yes, so it will be from the e-invoicing portal. So essentially, when you log into the e-invoicing portal, there is an option of generating e-way bill where you can provide your IRN number and the transport details and do it. So that will be available that is available from now also. Currently also, if you do it, that is available. If you go API through ASP GSPs, or if you go other route also, this API is available already, that you give IRN and transport details and you can generate the e-way bill.
So essentially in this case, what the government is trying to do is, if it is an invoice, any document on which IRN is generated, then e-way bill can be generated only from the IRP portal, not from any other portal. That's what the intent is.
Correct.
So be it you do it via manually or you use an API and all, you have to do it via the IRP system and not on e-way bill system will be the way forward, but only limited to the IRN generated invoices. So if you have an invoice Correct. On which IRN is not there, then for that you have to go to e-way bill portal only for generating your e-way bill number. E-invoicing as a mandate covers all type of invoices, be it for goods or be it for services. Well, e-way bill is only limited to goods. And this was answering another next question that was there. Then, is there any API wherein we can have GSTN address of vendor? So here, if I understand, you just want to provide a GSTIN and in return get the address of it. Then yes, there are APIs available for it. So some time ago, I just showed a screenshot of our application, which is Iris Peridot. So in Peridot, anyways, when you enter a GSTN, we display the principal place of address and also all the additional places from where it is operating. The same information what we show on the Peridot app is also available via API. So yes, via APIs, when you provide a GSTIN, you can get the address in detail if you want. How many mandatory fields are required for generating IRN?
Yeah, so total, so in all, I think around 30, not more than 30, 28 to 30 fields are there. Yes. Okay. And others will be conditional mandatory. So even if they're not directly mandatory, classic example is, your HSN, for example, is of goods, then quantity is mandatory. Unit is mandatory. But if it is services, then both of them are optional. So, there are certain those category of mandatory fields also. So direct mandatory, almost, 28 to 30 fields will be there.
So roughly about 50, if I can say the upper limit would be 50 fields which you need to take care, depending on what type of scenarios you will have. Then next question is, what about B2C invoices while uploading the B2B?
So B2C invoices are not supposed to be sent for iron generation. So if you continuously send B2C requests to NIT, they may block block your iron generation also, even for B2B. So you have to be very careful. So if you're using our system, this has been handled at our end directly. So for us, you need not worry. However, if you're doing a direct integration of for some other through some other thing, then you have to be very careful while not sending B2C.
Yeah, so in fact, of course, we jumped a lot in our presentation today. Usually we don't, we finish our slides and then pick up questions, but this time we thought, because questions are important, we'll address those. So the point I think here to note also is that NIC is going to track all the error cases that are there. So, like B2C case where it is clearly known that you're not supposed to send B2C invoice for iron generation. If you keep on sending that invoice, they may block you temporarily. So there are some certain things which NIC also and system is going to put into place so that the error rate comes down and the system is not unnecessarily blocked because of, all the wrong information that is coming to there. So those things will be there. So we had, one actually slide on, the go live experiences from iron. So I actually don't know now, because the plan was actually till 4:30 and we already are exceeded the time. So I'm thinking, should we we continue the questions or we show that go live experience?
So we continue the questions, because we'll anyways be sharing the PPT, so I think
is there a time limit to generate IRN after raising invoice? As of now, no.
IRN, though there is no time limit, but you have to ensure that you do not use any invoice for any purpose without IRN. So you cannot send it to your buyer without an IRN. You cannot move the goods without an IRN, or any purpose you cannot use it. So essentially, ideally it should be on a real time basis. So as soon as you raise an invoice, ideally IRN should be also generated. However, if there is a batch processing at your end that you send to the buyers, or you move the goods after month end or something like that, then it is your choice, because penalty provisions are applicable. So you will have to also ensure those things are in place. So yes.
Okay. Then if there are tax invoice and separate invoice for export, what is the solution? What is the solution? IRN would be only for tax invoice.
So IRN is for tax invoice, export invoice, but export invoice in Indian currency, so not in foreign currency. There are two fields, there are few main fields which are you can add, and there is an export section separately which you can add in your invoices for export data. These are like invoice value in foreign currency you can put. There are two columns for invoice value. One is normal column where you put it for all the invoices, and another column is foreign value invoice, currency invoice value. And the foreign currency So whether it is USD or AUD or whatever it is. And there is a separate section for export related fields like shipping bill details or export, etc. That also you can fill. Those are optional fields, but you can add. But all the other amounts are to be reported in INR. For export, IRN is compulsory.
Okay. Then next is scanner will be available for desktop app also. So this I'm assuming the QR code scanner that we are talking about. So generally what happens when you have to scan anything, you need a device. So, you know, like you go to shopping malls also, when you have done a purchase, there is a hard device which scans or what content is there. So if that kind of thing is there in your desktop, then obviously it can also scan. Otherwise, you need some external device, you know, in front of which you can keep the QR code and then it can be scanned. The alternative solution to this can be, you know, if you see in when we had shown our application as well, so the QR code content, whatever is received from the government, if you have that content, you can also, I mean, it's very, I won't say it's a user-friendly kind of thing, but you can also paste the content and get the result in return. It is one of the utility where you want to verify by QR code. So that also is an alternative that is there. So if you have the device with you, which is able to scan, then be it on desktop or wherever, it can scan it. But if that is not there, then you need to have the actual content of QR code, the machine readable content, which you can copy paste and your result should be seen. How about cancellation of e-invoice? Time once IRN is generated. So when can an IRN?
24 hours. So 24 hours window is there for cancellation.
Then can IRN be generated for B2C greater than 100 crores but no, less than 500?
No. So IRN generation is not there only for B2C, whether it's above 500 or above 100 crores. So B2C invoices, no IRN.
Is there any solution if NIC portal not working for any reasons? How do we handle that situation?
Yeah, so till now, if you see, you know, we have been monitoring the live system and it is working, at least API flow is working properly. On the NIC portal after login, I don't see any reasons if it is, you know, whether it will be for a long period of time, it will be shut down or something. You see, eWay Bill is also transactional in nature and they have handled it very nicely. So eWay Bill also doesn't have major issues as such, and we are expecting for IRP. Also, besides, they are going to have different multiple IRPs. So it will not be just single system. They will also have multiple IRPs so that, you know, load can be handled. That is...
Next is, I have made invoice on 1st December and want to generate IRN on 3rd December. Can we do?
So this we have answered, I think.
Yeah. So it is essentially, as of now, there is no time limit that is there on when you can generate an IRN. So you generate, your invoice is done today, but you are generating IRN on 3rd. So which means the document is valid only after an IRN is generated. Till that time, it is something you have, you know, preparatory copy you have prepared, but it gets a valid standing only once you have generated an IRN. Multi-trucks also we have seen. Is there a delivery challan also we have seen? Is API integration possible for inward supply of eWay Bill?
Yeah, so this is what type of API integration we'll have to check because for inward supply eWay Bill, already on the eWay Bill portal, if you see, recipients are allowed to fetch eWay Bill by eWay Bill number. There is a separate API also by date, I guess, through which you can fetch your inward supply eWay Bills. If it is regarding generating eWay Bill by a recipient, that is also available through eWay Bill, existing eWay Bill system. So yes, it is already there on the eWay Bill system. It is not going to come through IRP. So yes.
Then next, it is related to amendment, that invoice is amended, how can the physical copy be changed?
Correct. So that is what, you know, even we are not sure how, even not just changing the physical copy, but ultimately the ITC will be impacted, because currently also if you see when it comes to ITC, GSTM considers 2A or rather now 2B data. They take amended data rather than the original. But current coming, how this will amendment will work is still an open question.
Okay. Next is we are in services sector, and invoice don't need e-way bill. Services are not completed, and hence they amend invoices sent in mid of the month. That is, I think, what the perhaps case is.
Correct. So e-way bill, though it is not there, and if you amend the invoice after IRN generation or edit invoice after IRN generation, it will have an impact on not just on the recipient's IT, but also differences will be sent across to the tax. So it will depend upon what is the amount of amendment. So whether it is tax amounts is completely changed, how it is, or the recipient himself is completely changed, then it will become a problem. So our opinion, ideally, there shouldn't be any amendments. It should be either cancel and issue a new invoice or raise a note and generate IRN and issue a new invoice. So to cancel the old invoice, issue a credit note for the full amount, and then invoice. That is what we feel. However, these are our interpretations and solution, and no one has actually given any guidelines as such.
Next is, if we can just quickly explain how to get enable themselves on NIC portal. Just we have to send them, yeah, enabled on NIC portal.
Yeah, so there is an option on NIC portal. So if you go to e-invoice1gst.gov.in, there is an option under registration, enable e-invoicing. So from there you can, it is available online. So once you select that, you need to put your GST, and they will validate, and they'll ask some questions which you'll have to fill, like whether your turnover is above 500 crores or not, and then you can answer those and get yourself enabled.
Okay. Then another is, financial turnover is less than 100 crores, but GST turnover is more than 100 crores, is e-invoice applicable? So I think the definition of turnover is aggregate turnover, which is as per GST, is what we understand.
Correct.
So then e-invoice will be applicable because your GST turnover is more than 100 crores. If my turnover is 100 crores, of which 20 crores is B2C, balance 80 crores is B2C.
No, it is applicable. So it is turnover at PAN level, including all the transactions, irrespective of whether it is B2C or anything. So even exam for that matter will be included in the turnover definition.
Okay. TC, we have paid TCS on certain purchase. Can we get ITC on GST paid? Is the question.
So again, there are two types of TCS. One is your e-com related TCS, for which this will be under GST, so that there is a return called 2X, which you have to file, where you will get all the credits for TCS as well as TDS. And both you can file, and that gets included in your cash ledger once you file that return. However, TCS of income tax, it will not come in under GST. So if the TCS is of the nature income tax, which comes in your 26 years, then that will form part of the income tax process, not GST. So it is not ITC, it is a separate tax.
Okay. And whether this 100 crore includes RCM transactions, say, supplies from RCM?
Purchases of RCM will not be included, but yes, outward of RCM will be included. RCM invoices typically, get confused because there are two types where a self-invoicing is done on the purchase side. So those are not to be included. That is not a part of your turnover. It is just a transaction where recipient pays tax. As a recipient, you pay tax. But if you're supplying thing which is under RCM, then that needs to be included.
Okay. I think we still have, a couple of questions which you already addressed on delivery challan and again difference in generation. Anything specific for job work challan?
No.
Could we generate IRN for raw materials transferred through job work challan?
No IRN. Only an EVA bill will be there. There is an option delivery challan and there is an option supply type as job work you can put and send only when the final job if the job work location for sale happens and then the invoice is generated, then that will have the IRN. So only on invoices the typically IRN is required.
Okay. Because we still actually have questions and we already have like run exceeded a lot of time. I'm just sharing my screen. I hope you can see the email ID. So if you have any further questions or anything, you can always send it to support@irisgst.com. And many of the things that we discussed in our session today, this presentation slides is something we'll be sharing to our participants. And also we have an ebook on e-invoicing, which covers the steps and the flow and the content that has to go in e-invoice in detail. You can also refer that. That's an ready to refer kind of book, which can again clear some concepts around e-invoicing. And I do see that there are more questions, but unfortunately we won't be able to take any more questions. So thank you all for participation and actually for flooding us with questions. So therefore, we just impromptu, we took a decision not to go through our regular flow of slides, but focus more on Q&A because that is what is we feel more relevant, that you understand what are the areas and what are the things that impact you, so that the invoice becomes an easier journey for you. You can learn from what we have experienced, what the other companies have experienced, and it can simplify the journey for you. So thank you once again. And any questions, any queries, you can just send it to support@irisgst, or you can also refer to our blog, where we also put across all these common questions and things that we often see in webinars. We also post it on our blog, so you can also follow us on that. Thank you. And with this, we end our webinar today. And there are some questions which are, I think, not yet answered. So we'll see if we can convert that into some form and also put it as either blog or something on our website. So, and thank you, Vaishali. I think your detailed insights on actually working and having deep data experience and the system experience really addresses the queries to the point, and hence we are getting more and more queries. That's all I can say. So thank you so much, and thank you everyone for participating.
Thank you.